Hi, Desirae. I'm George Davis, the Executive Director of the California African American Museum. I'm really proud to be honored and featured today in the Person of Prominence segment.
George Davis is essential to the success of the California African American Museum. As a prominent and noteworthy leader in his community, Davis is informative and passionate about the important role he is in. Prior to coming aboard with CAAM, he was a seasoned and distinguished executive in the broadcasting and entertainment industry. He continues to remain involved and present by consistently networking with his peers so they can learn and grow together. Not only is he respected and admired, he's also culturally aware and makes a genuine effort to share information about CAAM to people from all over the world. The California African American Museum. Necessary, valuable, and unique. Find out more about George Davis and how this historic museum touches the lives of those near and far.
Welcome to my Person of Prominence segment, George.
Good morning. Thank you. It's an honor to be on.
Yeah, I'm really excited to speak with you because the museum is doing awesome things and you're doing incredible things there as well. And speaking of incredible things, you have an incredible history. You joined the museum staff in 2015, but from 1999 through the time you came on with the California African American Museum, you were a state-appointed board member for CAAM. So where did your interest in art stem from?
Well, first off, again, thank you for having me on. And the museum is a combination of art and history with a California focus. I had a long career in the broadcast and entertainment industry, and a lot of it, the later part of my career, a lot of it was international travel, setting up different cable networks around the world. And I needed something to kind of bide my time, so I started going to a lot of great museums and also started collecting rare books and just kind of saw how art was exhibited, how history was told, and also noted that very rarely was there anything about people of African descent. And if it was, a lot of it I didn't know about when I left the country. It was great stories about people. So I started collecting interesting books and interesting photos and just kind of had an interest in that. And then about 20 years ago, I had the opportunity of joining the board. The museum is a state museum, so we get appointed by the governor. And I was on that museum board for a couple of years and kind of stayed involved since my tenure on the board. But I got to a place in my career where I had a great career in the entertainment business, and I wanted to do something more service-oriented. So kind of, I won't go on the long story how that journey went right now, but it wound up where I was offered opportunity first to be the interim director of this museum, and then 4 months later I was made permanent. So I've been here about 4 years now.
That is so amazing. Good. So based on your opinion and your expertise and in your history, why are African American history museums an important part of the whole fabric of America?
Well, what happened is, if you look at the came out of the riots in the 60s, they did something called the Kerner Commission, where they had a study and they saw a lot of things that had occurred, like African Americans didn't see themselves positive role images on television. The news coverage was mainly people getting arrested. You didn't see anchor people on television. And so at that time, there was an outgrowth of what we call culturally specific institutions. So that's when you start seeing Chinese American Museum, Japanese American Museum, Latino African American Museums. Most of them, in terms of black community or history, are tied to a historical location, like the Edmund Pettus Bridge, where John Lewis crossed and the marchers got beat up, or you know, Martin Luther King's home. What's unique is at CAAM we had both history and art, and that's the uniqueness about our particular museum. But there are also a lot of museums that are only African American, that are only art. For example, Spelman Museum and the Hampton Museum, more known for art. But the challenge is not necessarily starting these museums, but sustaining them over a period of time.
Yeah, I'm sure that could be challenging. And I mean, even all the exhibits that you guys have there, because you have so many, and I'm sure you're fond of all of them, and you've seen so many throughout the years, but do you happen to have some personal favorites that you can tell us about?
Well, it's kind of like children. You can't mention that, right? So, so I'll say I personally love stories that are not always told. I love biographies. I love people that are kind of contrarian or swim against the tide. So I love reading about people like that. I love exhibits about that. But, you know, the main thing for us is a couple of things. One is that most museums skew toward people over 50. That's not just in the Black community. CAAM, for many years, was a museum that, in the same regard, was really geared toward older folks. And so I felt when I took over that, you know, my kids, my friends' kids weren't coming to CAAM, and my kids are grown now. But I just thought it was really important that we kind of change the direction of the museum so that it's much more relevant for younger people. We get, you know, much more engaged with social media. So, you know, I kind of, if it was about me, a lot of the exhibits I might not completely get because I'm not of that generation anymore. And but I feel like it's important of those that are part of this generation to kind of not put our thumb on everything. And I don't have to figure out everything. I don't have to understand everything, because how someone in their 20s or early 30s receives content is very different than someone in their 50s and 60s. So I personally like history exhibits. I like art more like Impressionism. I've grown to learn more about contemporary art, but then there's a lot of younger people that really love contemporary art, and they want history told in a different way where it's not just linear. You know, we grew up watching documentaries on PBS, and you look at what happened after Ken Burns started doing documentaries where they had music and, you know, people with gravelly voices, and all of a sudden it became a lot more interesting and vibrant. And so to me, it's really important not just to tell the history, not just to show the art, but to do it in a way where it's more relevant for the younger generations, because a lot of these institutions were built by people older than me that really wanted deeply and felt the importance of having culture-specific institutions. But if they don't evolve past the 60s and 70s, then they go out of business. You look at what happened with the Ebony Jet collection of archives that recently the organization went bankrupt. And again, you know, not to knock anybody, but it comes down to, are you evolving? Are you changing? Are you, you know, kind of coming along with digital? You look, you know, Toys R Us went out of Blockbuster. Right? We used to buy catalogs. We had catalogs for Sears when I was a kid. That's how we bought stuff. So you can't still be doing catalogs with internet, you know. So it's just important that these institutions that were founded for a good reason evolve. And the other thing that's unique is that before Black art was not shown in these major institutions in the past, so a museum like the African American Museum, or like CAAM, was one of the only places that they could show their work. And now in L.A. in particular, we have this amazing time where we have, I think, four or five different major African-American exhibits up at the same time. The Broad has Soul of a Nation that's been to London and New York and now in L.A. Charles White, who's from Los Angeles, a great African-American artist, there's a great retrospective at LACMA. You have a hip-hop photography exhibit, the Annenberg Space for Photography. You have a new exhibit photographer named Kwame Brakewith, who's African-American, but it's at a Jewish institution called the Skirball. So there's just such a change has occurred, and also major galleries are now exhibiting African-American art. So the need for a culture-specific institution definitely was needed. I believe it's still needed, but now we have to step up our game because we're not the only place showing it anymore.
That's right. That's right. I like that you mentioned the generational thing with, you know, your generation, vice maybe the younger generation, and how you know, people are going to view art differently and how you kind of are drawn to the historic parts of the museum and while somebody else might be drawn to other areas. So that's important to know because there's something for everybody at the museum. And people always have their favorites, right, from books to movies and,
yeah,
and art. So what is something that
people like?
Well,
I think if I could jump in real quick, I think the tricky part is trying to satisfy everybody. And I think that's where a lot of institutions get in trouble. And if you look at the TV, media, internet, it's very niche, very very specific brand that's occurring. When I was growing up, ABC, CBS, NBC did everything. And that's not longer the case anymore. So, you know, we just decided we couldn't do everything for everyone. And we certainly still do intergenerational stuff. But we've decided that we want this museum to be around when our generation is gone.
Mm-hmm.
And you look at a lot of Black churches and a lot of Black, you know, you look at the power of the NAACP back in the day, the Urban League. It's just not the same as it was before. So the question is, you know, did it evolve? Did it evolve to digital and so forth? Or are you trying to do too much? Or are you fighting yesterday's battles? And so I think those side of things are really important questions for the boards and the senior leadership, and to try to also evangelize the community to understand when you are making these changes that you're doing it for the greater good, for it to be around, because it's impossible to have reggae on Monday, jazz on Tuesday, you know, gospel on Wednesday, to cover slavery, to cover everything with African Americans in one building. It's just not real. It's not realistic, and that's the kind of pressure we get from the community. And so we have to kind of just say, well, you know what, we're going to go in a certain direction. We're going to be very intentional in that direction. And fortunately, it's worked very well where we've tripled the attendance in the last couple of years.
Yeah, you've done an awesome job with that. And you mentioned slavery, and I want to ask you a little bit about that when it comes to an historical view. Because one thing people may not realize is that, you know, slavery was just not limited to the southern states. It was all over in California as well. So how does CAAM recognize that part of Black history?
Well, it's funny you mention this. We just had an exhibit up that just came down called California Bound, Slavery on the New Frontier. California was not a slave state, but what were the issues if you brought a slave here? What were the laws and so forth? And so there, we deal with that fact in our exhibits, in our public programming, and it is something that especially our Black patrons are very interested in. But I also believe, again, as I said earlier, a Jewish institution can't just always only do the Holocaust. The Japanese Museum just can't continue always to do the internment. You have to have those issues, but you have to also just be mindful of the changing demographics of the city and so forth and the community you're serving. You know, there's a lot of people of different backgrounds that are African descent that might not be African American. There's people that are mixed. There's all different type of people that come into these institutions. So, no, again, we've done exhibits about slavery. But again, we're California focused in general as an institution because we're a state institution. So we're trying to look at it from a California point of view, which is very different than the museums in the South. Or if you go to a former plantation and they show the slave cabins and so forth, a little different focus on our end.
Right, right. Like showing information about how the freed slaves came to California to settle in.
Absolutely. A great story about Biddy Mason, who came here and appealed to the court here and was able to become free. And she bought up parcels of land in downtown L.A. and was the founder of the first AME church here in L.A. So there's a great story. That was one of the stories that was featured in our exhibit that just left the museum about 2 weeks ago.
That's very interesting. And I'm sure many people enjoy walking through, you know, at their leisure at the museum at their own pace. But do you also offer guided tours?
Yeah, we do guided tours. We offer guided tours for groups. We do docent tours. We have every exhibit. A lot of museums do this. They have a walkthrough in the beginning where you can look on the internet. Most museums will have something when a new exhibit opens where you will see a walkthrough. The actual curator will have a group of people explain the pieces, and you get a deeper understanding of the artworks or the intention of the artist or a little more background, the history. But, yeah, definitely we do provide tours. Plus we have volunteer docent councils that are also available to help out with the public, especially when we have the large events.
Okay. And you talked a little bit about early on when we were talking in the beginning about how the museum incorporates art and history. So what else sets the California African American Museum apart from some of the others across the nation?
Well, the main thing I'd say is that we're a state museum. Most African American museums are nonprofit. They might be city, might be county funded. The one that's, of course, got a lot of recognition is the new Smithsonian African American Museum in D.C., which is a federal museum. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that when most people think about, I'll back up a little bit. If you go to the Smithsonian Museum, which is a great museum, the African American Museum, there's, you know, very little bit about the West Coast. And most people, they think of the West Coast as African American, think of celebrities, they might think of athletes. But they, when they compare it to Jim Crow, Civil Rights Movement, Martin Luther King, Harlem Renaissance, even as far west as Chicago, they just don't see us as part of the struggle the same way. Maybe the Panthers, because they came from the Bay Area. And so the founders of this museum wanted to really make sure that it focused on the uniqueness of African-American journey to California and the unique artists and history of California. So that's one thing that differentiates us, along with us being blessed, frankly, to be funded by the state of California and not have to hustle the same way that a nonprofit does to sustain themselves.
Okay, okay. Thank you for answering that. And, you know, just recently, we talked about this too earlier, you know, in the news we heard about, you know, Johnson Publishing Company filing for bankruptcy, and then later it was announced that George Lucas and Melody Hobson would be fighting to seek control over the Ebony and Jet archive. So do you think there are any other alternatives, and could any of those archives possibly end up in a Black History Museum or divided amongst, you know, a variety of Black History Museums?
Well, that's a really good question. We have a situation here in California with the Mamie Clayton Library that I've been involved with, where they have 2 million artifacts, books, ephemera, posters, photos, and they're in a building that is falling apart that the county owns, and that they're now in a position where they need to relocate the building. And our big concern is that they're not in a position where these items get auctioned off, where these get sold out to people around the world. So I just think, you know, the time in the past, people looked for someone else to be a savior outside the community. And I just think we have enough wealth in this community, enough expertise, that we should be able to pool our resources through either institutions or individuals or, you know, foundations, nonprofits or whatever, to purchase a lot of these archives. A lot of the people that did great things in the Black community are getting up in age. You know, the people who are the first this, the first general, the first CEO, all these folks are now getting up to the age where they're passing. And they have papers. They have, you know, unique histories. In the Jewish community, they do the oral histories where they're doing, mm-hmm. you know, recording people that the Holocaust and so forth, so they're maintained for eternity, for history. So I just think that we have to do the same thing. It doesn't have to only come from a Black institution. There's a lot of other institutions that look at this as American history. That's important to look at it too. So, you know, my hope is that it's not chopped up into sold off at auction in terms of Johnson Publishing, and that the Lucas, how they decide if they're able to obtain it, how they're, you know, what entity that they decide is going to house those archives, whether they stay in Chicago, which might make logical sense, or, you know, what place houses it. It's, again, it's just really important. We had a great institution here, Golden State Life Mutual Insurance Company, for years, where African Americans weren't sold insurance policies. They go through this entity. They had a great, amazing art collection. And, you know, as times changed, where people could go to other life insurance companies, Golden State, you know, kind of wind it down. And, you know, they had all this great art. And so the community in L.A. was not able to come together to retain it, so it went to auction. So we're trying to avoid the same thing with another institution here in L.A., and this thing is going on around the country. And I just think looking for someone else to save it is not the answer. It's kind of a local effort to people get their egos out of the way and figure out not only how to save it, but where is it going to go so that it's maintained, cataloged correctly, and managed properly.
And that is so true, what you mentioned. I mean, it's a community effort. You know, there's lots of history, and we need to come together somehow and pull funds together or something to come up with a way to make sure these things are salvaged or put in the proper place and, like you said, cataloged correctly. And, you know, being, you know, something that we can look forward to having our children and our children's children look at, you know.
If you're only letting your community know about your history, then how is that changing stereotypes, right? So we need to make sure, like, 40% of our attendance is now non-African American. So we want people to come in to learn about, because also they start buying, the collectors of Black art are not just African Americans. You know, mm-hmm. in fact, most of them probably are not. So that helps to raise the boats, the value of the art. And also, as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot more institutions doing exhibits now. So it's important, yes, totally important for our own kids and grandchildren and future. But also, we're in a country that has some major schisms at this time racially that have continued for, you know, centuries. And the more we understand each other through whether it's watching documentaries or movies or reading books or seeing great art, or seeing the actual slave shackles or seeing the actual blackface or how we depict it versus talking about it, it really makes people have a different type of reaction than just talking about it. They can see the actual image of what occurred. They actually see Birth of a Nation. They're going to get it differently. But if it's only black people seeing it, then, you know, you're kind of preaching to your own choir only.
And that's true. I think it's something that, you know, everybody should learn about. And you said something important about being able to appreciate something from a different perspective by just hearing it and seeing it. It's two different things, and it kind of hits home a little bit differently, packs a bigger punch when you're actually seeing it and internalizing all of those things that have happened.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's like people think, Instagram is great to see a lot of art and photography, and I enjoy it. It's a good platform, but there's nothing like seeing a Gordon Parks photo in person and seeing, you know, a rare book in person. So on one hand, it's great to digitize these things because some people will never be able to go to CAAM, but if they can look on the Internet and see our shots of our exhibits, our shots of the art we have in our permanent collection, you know, it still works. But at the same point, there's nothing like going there, going to the pyramids, seeing the pyramids versus hearing about the pyramids and seeing the camels and the people and the tourists. There's a whole different smell and, you know, versus watching National Geographic Channel special in the pyramids, you know.
That's true. You get more of your senses involved when you're actually up close and personal with things. And speaking of being up close and personal, there are not only exhibits at CAAM, but you also have workshops and a book club. So what kind of process goes into selecting the work to display from a particular artist, or what if somebody wants to do a workshop there? What kind of process is involved with
that? So normally, and this is a general for most museums, normally is in quotes, normally the public programs are tied to either an exhibit that's on view or a theme they're doing for a summer or a season or something. So we had a theme called Radical Self-Care a year or two ago. And so we went through hair and yoga and all these things. It was skewed a little more toward women, but it was a theme. We had another theme that was activism now. So we had Angela Rye and David Banner and Maxine Waters. So those things are kind of driven by the museum. Things that normally don't fit into our bucket a lot of times are either a rental or sometimes we'll do, even the things we do with the kids might be tied to a current exhibit. And that is, again, it kind of helps us with focus. The smaller museums have more flexibility to do more, you know, grassroots community-based, the smaller cultural arts institutions. But you get to a state museum or a larger museum, it's you know, you're trying to satisfy, you know, it's just a different type of focus. But that doesn't mean we don't do, you know, community-based things. It's just that we just, it's not really our sweet spot compared to a local library or a local art center where, you know, we're trying to have more, become more of a nationally known institution.
Okay. Well, I mean, you, of course, are doing great things in many different places, because aside from being the executive director of CAAM, you also are heavily involved with community advocacy groups and organizations that help veterans. So would you share a little bit about that?
Yeah, I many years ago, well, let me back up a little bit. I would see, you know, people underneath the bridges and overpasses, they're homeless. And I, you know, many cases thought that there's just no way they could turn their life around. When I worked at Sony Pictures, one of the executives there was a Vietnam veteran. He's a Caucasian gentleman. He's a lieutenant of Vietnam. And he was concerned that the board for this organization that helped veterans who had substance abuse problems and mental illnesses, that the entire board was Caucasian, and the people that they were mainly assisting were African-American. At the time, I was doing a lot of the boards and didn't think that I had time to do it, but he smartly asked me to go on a tour, and I just got really involved with the group. And I just went on a journey and seeing these men who were able to reconnect with their families. They might not be able to reconnect with their wives, but their kids, they would get gainful employment, clean up their lives. And it was a center that was much more nimble than the VA and much more responsive. And so I was on the board for like 11 years, and I was not a veteran, but I just had a personal interest with it to see people change their life. These people have served their country. And, you know, especially the Vietnam-era veterans that came back, and they were not supported. It was a very unpopular war. A lot of them self-medicated. And you just didn't have the services that they have now. So it's just something that, you know, I missed the draft by a year or two for the Vietnam War. And, you know, I saw some of my friends go there. And I have friends that have gone. And it still affects them today. So
right.
I just think it's really important. And, in fact, you know, the Iraq War and the Afghanistan War, so few people, unless you live in San Diego or somewhere or some military town, so many people they know no one in the military, you know. And so they come back out and they don't have the support system. And I just think, regardless of how you feel about the war, what party you're in, you know, these people are serving our country, putting their life at risk, their families to rest when they're gone for long stays. And I just think it's important, those of us that are not serving, to be supportive.
I think that's so true. You know, I come from a military family. My father was a retired colonel in the Army, and he was in Vietnam. And I think that, you know, the awareness of the sacrifices and the challenges that a lot of the Vietnam vets went through is important to recognize. So I'm glad that that's something that you have involved yourself in over the years. And
well,
aside from
know,
that, okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I was just going to say is that I just felt like, you know, when you have the opportunity to move in circles that maybe a lot of people don't move in, and then, you know, you're fortunate that people either listen to you or are open to your recommendations for vendors, for people to get hired. If you're not taking advantage of that, especially as African American, then to me that's almost a crime. And so,
yeah.
And so I just think, you know, you have to find time to be of service, whether it's on a nonprofit board or helping people at the gala or other kind of things, especially those of us who are in the business community who have different skills, because a lot of people have a lot of things from the heart, but they don't have the business skills. So they have the passion about something. Their grandmother had Alzheimer's, something they're really passionate about, but they don't know how to put a nonprofit together. They don't know how to put a board together. They don't know how to, you know, put an organization together, hire and fire, all the difficult things, the sausage making of making these things work. And I think those of us that are blessed to have that knowledge, you don't have to wait till you're 70 or 80 to share it. You know, we're supposed to share it while we can. And so I've been on boards for over, you know, 25 years, and I enjoy it. And that's kind of how I led to make a career change from broadcasting, by just enjoying the board service. But again, there's only so much you can do on a board versus running the place. And that's kind of where I came to a point where I decided I wanted to run a place versus continue to serve on boards. But I think it's really important. There's a group in L.A. called ABLE, African American Board Leadership Institute, that is what happened was the same African Americans, the folks that are not African American, they know those folks, and so you start seeing the same people in each community. They're on a lot of boards. They get burned out. So they start training people about serving on these nonprofit and government boards, and they've been around for like 10 years now. They probably have graduated 300 or 400 people that now have gone out and have learned about, you know, because a lot of folks, if their parents weren't on boards, they don't really know how you get on a board. So it's been something that's become a national, people have paid attention nationally to start other organizations like that around the country.
Well, thank you for giving, you know, your time to those kind of organizations. I wish more people would do that and actually see the importance, like you do, in giving back to the community and making sure people are aware of those things. So what do you think the most important, well, not really important, but what's the most rewarding aspect of working with the California African American Museum?
You know, seeing kids in here and seeing kids, their eyes bright and excited. It's seeing the community come in and see a clean, well-run place and the pride they have that they want to have their rental events here. Or they want to, you know, show, and if anything, I'm telling people no a lot because they all want to come here with different exhibits, and I spend a lot of my time, unfortunately, saying no. But it's just personally, you know, the museum – has had good days and good years and bad years, and I took over it, and it had been in some difficulty. So just to be able to see how it's kind of been transformed. And I guess the best thing is to see young people in here that when we have our openings and they're dancing and they're in the food trucks and they're doing selfies and they're meeting dates. And they, before, most museums, you know, the Broad has a pretty young demographic, but most museums, they, you don't see that. So, and also to see people of all different races here dancing, having a good time, curious. You know, like when we do MLK Day, we got like 7,000 people that came by that day, all types of races and ethnic groups. And so it's just L.A. and Southern California is a unique place, very diverse, and I just felt like, you know, you just don't want only Japanese going to a Japanese museum, only Jewish,
right,
Jewish museum. You want to people to learn about different cultures and to get young people to get energized about culture and art, and that's what I'm most proud about.
You know, thank you for sharing that. I can imagine, you know, how rewarding that is to see, you know, those aha moments, you know, with the kids or even adults, you know, who are learning something new, or they, you know, thought they knew a lot about something, but coming to the museum, they find out they, you know, needed to know more. They're learning more about something. And I think that's important because learning never stops. And no matter how old you are, learning never stops. And the more that you know about history, whether it's your culture or somebody else's culture, is an important part of just living and growing and being well-rounded. So for people who want to visit the museum or have been thinking about visiting the museum, what would you like them to know about planning a trip?
Well, we're in the Exposition Park section of Los Angeles, which is south of downtown or close to USC. Expo Park is going through an amazing renaissance. We have the California Science Center next door. We have the Memorial Coliseum, where two Olympics have occurred, and the Rams were playing there for now until they moved to Inglewood. The USC football team has been playing there forever. We're going to be having the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art, which is almost an $800 million project. It's going to be coming on the Vermont side of the park. So the park, it's sometimes difficult to get in because the, you know, football game might be going on in some place. So we're in Expo Park. We're also available by the Expo line. It stops right there at the Rose Garden, so you can take the line in here too. Of course, you can do rideshare services. You can go to CAAM.org, www.caammuseum.org, to look about our exhibits. You can follow us on all the social media platforms. We are free admission, which I should have mentioned earlier, which is real cool. Parking is about $12 to come in the daytime, $15 a night. And that parking revenue, it does help us a little bit with our budget. And so, yeah, there's just a lot of ways of coming. We do e-blasts also. If you get you can get on our e-blast list. But I think social media, we always, you know, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook are also showing what we're doing. We also put a brochure out called Here and Now Quarterly that is lays out the exhibits and the public programs that are coming up. So a lot of touch points we get out there to the community.
Lots of neat things are going on at the museum. And George Davis, it's been a pleasure talking with you about all the wonderful things you're doing at the California African American Museum. And I'm looking forward to hearing more and more about the exhibits that are going to be shown and all the great things that you're doing in the community.
Well, thank you so much. And, of course, I want to make another